Hello, everyone who is already here. It's nice to see you. Thank you for joining today to this EuroTech talk. EuroTech talks are a loose series of scientific talks that we organize within the EuroTech Universities Alliance. And for each of those tech talks, we invite two speakers from two of our universities. And the idea is really to show the collaboration that is going on within our universities, between our universities. And today, I'm very pleased to welcome a prime example of such a collaboration, because our two speakers today, their collaboration reaches way back. So welcome, Professor Francisco Pereira. He is heading the Machine Learning for Smart Mobility Group at DTU, the Technical University of Denmark. And also Constantinos Antoniou, who holds the Professorship for Transportation Systems Engineering at the Technical University of Munich. And welcome to both of you. The two professors are going to deliver a talk today on efficiently learning across open data sets, and will focus particularly on the transport research. So a last word for me before we officially kick off. The meeting today will be recorded and published afterwards, since our two speakers have kindly agreed that we do that. They are also very happy to share slides afterwards. And if you have questions during the talk, feel free to write them in the chat and we will address them afterwards. If you are targeting one of the speakers particularly, please mention that in your questions. And if it's a general question, just put it in the chat. And then at the end, we will have a Q&A session, and then you're also welcome to turn on your microphone and speak up. And please, if you want to do that, raise your virtual little hand and then we will call you on stage. But that's it from my side. Welcome, and I hand over to one of our speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita, for the introduction. So it will start with me, Francisco. I'm from DTU. I'll start by saying that for those of you that know, Costas and I know that we are both working in transport, but we have both a kind of a strong angle in machine learning data science. So we work with data from different cities, different contexts, different types of problems, all around, generally around transportation. So it makes a lot of sense that we both are interested in this general topic of efficiently learning across data sets. So this talk will focus on two general methodologies. Because this is a relatively short time, the focus will be more on giving you the intuition behind those techniques, more than getting you to really be ready to use them yourself. So in the end of this talk, we have a few suggestions for tutorials and video lectures that are, trust me, they are really, really good. So if you are excited about this, and for us, if in the end we convince you that these are really cool tools to use and you go on, it's going to be a success for us. So this talk will have four parts. The first one will be about the general methods, the two general methods that I mentioned. So I'll give you the intuition behind them from a machine learning perspective. And then we go into data, or about open data sets and what sort of the current state of open data sets in transport. And then we go to parts three and four are about basically the two examples that we have. And one is with meta learning, which is one of the techniques, and the other one is with transfer learning, which is the second technique. All right, so I will now try to give you sort of the intuition for those techniques. I'll start with a motivation. As I said, we've been working with data sets from all over the place, especially related with transport. So, of course, it only makes sense that we try to apply machine learning on those and so on. But the landscape, as Costas will show, is kind of odd in terms of, some places have very rich data sets, some don't have so much data at all. Some types of problems have very low or very small data sets in general. The data is extremely heterogeneous, so there are some, you know, features in one place that are absent in the other, noise in one that there's not in the other. So it's quite exciting, but at the same time, it's also very challenging. So the thing is, can we somehow, instead of doing, you know, on a piecemeal approach where each context is a new model that we do from scratch, can we try to have machine learning methods where from case to case, from task to task, we can then reuse some of the data, reuse some of the knowledge that we learned, reuse some of the modeling. So can we generalize across different problems, across different data sets? And by doing this, can we make the training and the use of machine learning transport more efficient? And again, I mean, we are focused on transport, but I'm pretty sure that for those of you that are not working with transport as a topic, that a lot of this is applicable in your areas. All right. So, sorry, I'm having some issue here. Okay. So, the two methods are called meta learning and transfer learning. We'll proceed to explain what they are. So the first one is called meta learning, which means basically learning how to learn. So you can imagine the learning how to learn idea is like, you can imagine that you have different tasks that you that are somehow related. In this case, we have 10 tasks all somehow related with demand prediction. With in different cities for different types of modes, but generally the architecture of the neural network or the assumptions, the rules of the game are related. So now the typical approach is to go to each task and train a model from scratch with individual data sets. But like I said, I mean, yeah, it's good that you can sort of gain knowledge, transfer knowledge for, you know, as you learn more and more tasks. Okay. Now the question is, if you treat each task as a supervised learning in this case, can you have a machine learning model on top of it that learns how the different, you know, individual machine learning models learn? Okay. If it does that efficiently, then the principle is that you can, as you proceed to the next task, you should be able to advance to have a more efficient training. So this leads to the concept of few-shot learning. Maybe some of you have heard of this expression. So few-shot learning, few-shot means you don't have many examples to learn from. So k-shot learning is sort of a generalized expression, means, basically k is the number of examples that you need to learn a certain task. So to give you an idea of how few K can be, it can even be zero. In fact, the case that I will talk about from DTU is with zero shot. So that means you learn from a certain context from different tasks before, and you get to a new task and you don't even have examples and you predict from scratch, for example. That's quite extreme. But in few shot learning, it's quite common to have really a small number of examples. So when we say few, we really mean few. So how do we do this? We generally follow we try to mimic the human learning process itself. So for example, in images learning concepts, when we see a new object, we don't get back to all our previous mental images and learn again, right? I mean, we don't get, whenever you have a new image or new concept that you are learning about, that someone tells you, you know, this is an object of, you know, with a certain kind, you don't get back to all your previous things you learned and train your neural network again. You basically increment, you build in your existing knowledge, right? So it's more or less this philosophy that we use. So I'm going to talk about now two methods within meta learning. It's two families of methods. One is the black box methods. The other one is gradient based methods. The black box methods basically follow the idea of learning as a sequence learning problem. So sequences in machine learning, sequence learning is relates, for example, with time series, with a text or a natural language processing, with images or videos, not images. So anything that has some sort of sequence or continuity is considered a sequence learning problem. In our case, in the case of meta learning, the idea is that you have a sequence of tasks, okay? Well, in general, we would have each of the tasks to basically be trained individually, right? So like I said before, in the case of meta learning, the idea is that you train, let's say task one, and you learn, you know, the in this case could be like the weights of a neural network, and you could transmit something from those weights. Now, this something is what we call knowledge or intermediate state or something like that. There's different names. But the idea is that, yeah, you transmit, you know, for the next task, you transmit a certain, yeah, latent representation. For those of you that have that familiar with deep learning, it's the, I mean, you basically transmit embeddings that come from these previous neural networks. And this is the moment where I tell you that to get into more detail, I strongly recommend you to go through the through those tutorials. This will become much more clear. I know right now this is quite abstract, but yeah, it's the idea is to for meta learning is basically to learn what is the best representation that you learn at this level, such that at each new task, besides the, you know, the inputs and outputs that you give to this task, you also give something that can sort of push forward the learning process. This one, I think, is more intuitive to explain and understand. For this one, if you know a little bit of neural networks, for example, you know that the goal of training is to start with some initial parameters that can even be randomly initialized. And the goal of the learning is to basically to find these final set of parameters, those that solve the problem the best way. And to do that, you use some of this sort of gradient descent process. Now imagine that instead of starting always from scratch, always from zero, you start from a, let's say, common thread that is, let's say, that is common across different tasks that allows you to basically only fine tune those parameter sets from this common version, this common starting point, to those final weights. Of course, for each task, you'd have a different set of final weights. So you can imagine that this is some sort of a pre-baked neural network where it, which doesn't really solve one problem, actually doesn't solve any problem, but it's in a state that you just need a few examples to learn to solve one of the problems that you want to solve. So this one is called a MEML. Okay. So these are the meta learning methods that I wanted to talk to you about. This is, you know, you have this general idea that you have a sequence of tasks or a bunch of tasks, and you learn some sort of intermediate representations. In this case, it's these pre-baked version of the neural network. Such that whenever you have a new task to solve, it's going to be much faster. You need much less examples. So now to the transfer learning part. So it's a second, let's say, family of methods. Transfer learning it's aims generally towards the same goals, but meta learning is you can see it as a good solution when you have multiple tasks with small data sets. So it's not necessarily unbalanced. It's just that you have not so big data sets. And, you know, in deep learning, usually needs really large data sets. So meta learning helps you sort of overcome this by using, you know, data from multiple tasks. But transfer learning is particularly good for when you have very unbalanced scenarios, where you have one problem that has a lot of data and another problem that is related that has much less data. And this follows the idea that deep neural networks process input data into gradually increasing levels of abstraction. So what does this mean? I think especially with images, this is more clear. So for many tasks, like in image recognition, you have at the last layers, you may have something that is very specific to that task, but the first layers, you have something that is generic. For example, in image recognition, you have classification of objects of, I don't know, cats versus dogs, for example. And you, let's say that you have a really large data set for that. Now, you could train a model that distinguishes cats and dogs. This sounds trivial, but only a few years ago, this was a really hard task for machine learning. But now it's pretty much accomplished. Now, the thing is, for cats versus dogs, the first few layers are not really searching for anything that is particularly about cats or dogs. It's only in the last layer that sort of the network puts everything together. But in the first few layers, it basically looks for patterns, for segments, for brightness patterns, for lines, some geometrical shapes, things like that, that you find in any image. So that means that when you go to a different problem, let's say you want to classify military objects and you have a very small data set. So in that case, again, in the first few layers, maybe you only need to take into account the general image properties, not necessarily about military objects. So the idea here is to freeze or to learn the first part of this neural network and then just copy it transfer it to the new problem. This picture is just the same idea, but now with the transformers, which is basically what's behind ChatGPT kind of these language models. So for transfer learning, there's a question, obviously, why learn always from scratch? So what we do is to transfer the knowledge from one task to another one. And this is basically, this is the general algorithm. So you create a good model with a large enough data set, you freeze part of that model, typically everything except for the last few layers. And for each new problem, with a small data set, you reuse that frozen part and then train only the last few layers. So that means that in the case of images, you would have, the first few layers, the last layers were cats versus dogs, and then you just copy, the first layers. And now you only need to focus on training this much smaller number of parameters. And so therefore you need less examples. And that's it. This is just another picture that is basically the same idea. Right. So I'll pass to Kostas. Now, can you? You're muted.
Yeah. Thanks, Francisco. So it's just a small part about data openness that I'm going to talk about, and then pass back to Francisco for the first type of case studies, and then go back to transfer learning on my side. So if we would please go to the next slide. When we were working on this project, a DFK-funded project with colleague Rolf Merkel, also from TUM, and the people that you see here in the paper below. This is primarily work of my PhD student, Vishal Mahayan. And we were internally trying to talk with each other about the work that we're doing in the project, which had to do with these kind of things. And we were saying, public data, open data, this data, that data. And it was not clear to us what we meant. And if we who are working together all day cannot really know what we mean with these terms, we realized that there was an issue and we had to work a little bit on a typology and categorization of open data. Looking in the literature, because of course, very rarely you start with something that nobody else had thought about or done before, we found this very interesting. Now you cannot see my cursor, of course, but on the top right, you see this kind of target thing, these concentric circles, which was developed 20 years ago, but has not been used a lot. And we adapted it to what you see in the bigger colorful circle. So what are we trying to show here? We start with a large circle of all data. Within this data, there is a subset that are known data, right? They are data that we know that exist, because very often we are surprised that there are open data sets very relevant to our work and we don't know about them until somebody, publishes a paper on these or mentions them. Now, within this known data, there is a subset of data that are legally attainable. So some we cannot get, but some others we can't get. And within these, there are other subsets, for example, usable data. I don't know if it has happened to you, but it has happened to me that somebody is very excited to say, we have exactly the data that you need. They describe it. Indeed, it seems very interesting. They say, yeah, we're going to give you. We're going to give you counts for the area that you need, a lot of counts, hundreds of sensors for years and so on. And then what do? Either they send you a flat PDF or a printed like folder. Here are the data. I mean, these data are not really usable. Another subset is the issue of price and affordability. And here, it's not necessarily what somebody could say, what are you complaining about? The one is in Denmark, the other is in Germany. You shouldn't be complaining about the price of buying some data. But the point is that, let's say we can buy the data and we develop a model and then we want everybody to use it, then everybody will also have to keep buying data and so on. So there are other issues. It limits the access to the data. Another thing that might also be interesting is the bottom right, accessibility. So quite often it has happened that we had to send somebody to the US with a hard drive to get data that people were willing to give us, or somebody had to ship a hard drive or a USB stick to somewhere else across the US, for example, to get some data. So these things might seem funny to you, but have been issues. And then there are sorts of intersections and overlaps of these areas. And in the core, there is what we really call open data. So data that are known, legally attainable, usable, affordable, accessible, and distributable. As you can see, we have to be careful about how we call them. Just an example, legally attainable. Within the not legally attainable data, we include Twitter data. So a lot of people, including my former PhD student, Manos Haniotakis, for example, have been using Twitter. And Manos was always starting his presentations by saying, look, what I'm doing here is not permitted. The data, collecting this data is not permitted by the Twitter terms of use, but they don't bother us yet. So let's hope they don't bother us until I finish my PhD. Anyway, great. So next slide, please. And here there is an overview of the different types of data that we have. If we start at the bottom right quadrant, we have inaccessible data. So data like the internal of some companies that there's no chance that we're going to get. If we move left to the top left quadrant, we have commercial data, for example, data from mobile phone network operators, which we can get, but there is always a cost related with that. Then if we move to the bottom left quadrant, we have data that may be free, but there are restrictions in using them. And then at the bottom right, we have the so-called holy grail of open data, like OpenStreetMap data and data from other open databases, like the databases of Paris, of TFL, et cetera, that people can use in general for any applications. And with this quick talk on data and open data, I'll give it back to Francisco to continue with his part of the slides.
Thank you. All right. So, yes. So now we get to the third part. I know this is all very fast, but I hope you can get inspired with some of these things that this is useful for you. So this the third part is then about a example about meta learning, or specifically meta reinforcement learning for autonomous mobility on demand. So I believe most of you would know what this means. It's when you have put together autonomous vehicles and mobility on demand services like Uber or Lyft. Now, of course, the assumption here is that vehicles can be controlled in an automated and centralized manner. It doesn't have to be centralized, in fact, but definitely automated. In a way, they represent a sort of adaptive transportation system, or yeah, this is a general expression. But the thing is, to have AMoD, and there's been a lot of discussion about autonomous mobility in the last few years. I myself am not so convinced that it's a holy grail for transportation sustainability, for example. But regardless, if we don't have a good, efficient AMoD service, for sure, you're not going to have a good, sustainable and good solution. Now, so what is the problem that we want to solve from an AMoD perspective? The thing that we focus on is mostly rebalancing. And why? Because from a control perspective, the problem is dispatching. So that means when you have demands, so calls of people, requests of trips, then you have supply, so vehicles in different places. The dispatching is well studied already. So we have a lot of operations research methods that can do this very efficiently. The rebalancing, on the other hand, is not so obvious, because rebalancing is when you have delivered the service, where should you send your car to? And of course, this is very dependent on where the demand will be. And so there's some sort of a predictive component here. So it's not as, let's say, I won't say straightforward, because none of it is straightforward, but at least it's less predictable for sure. So what we have been applying in my group for this is reinforcement learning. And I know that the talk today is not about reinforcement learning. So I just basically this slide to give the idea what it is. I also added tutorials and then video lectures for that, if you're interested. So what is it? It's a mathematical formalism for learning-based decision-making. So for let's say control systems. Importantly, it's an approach for learning decision-making from experience, which is very important for us in the context of AMoD, because of course, again, from a meta learning perspective, you have different cities, different experiences, different reactions from, you know, feedback from demand and so on. And specifically, why reinforcement learning versus other control mechanisms? Because reinforcement learning, you can couple it with, for example, deep learning models, and that means you can handle unstructured data. And also it makes no assumptions on how the world works. What this means is that you can see it as basically an agent that receives, that sees a state of the world and can make decisions on that state of the world and get rewards. So it does not need to understand exactly how the world works internally, as opposed to, for example, simulation tools that some of us have been working with. All right. So given that we have a reinforcement learning method that learns the rebalancing for autonomous mobility on demand, let's consider a problem where we have multiple cities where we want to deploy autonomous mobility. If you do always from scratch, and reinforcement learning is actually can be an onerous process, in fact, because it's not just about looking for the best options, it needs to see bad options. And that's not good if you each time you move to a new city, you experiment with bad options, right? So we cannot really afford to retrain in every city. And quite often you don't really have much previous experience, because AMoD is a new service, right? So in our case, what we did was we basically simulated, the world. In our case, is based on a simulator, a simple simulator that uses open data sets from all around the world. And basically for each one, you'd have a task, you know, like Shenzhen, Bao'an, autonomous mobility and service is different than Shenzhen East and so on and so forth. So these are different tasks for our reinforcement learning agent. So what we did was to do this cycle that I mentioned to you before with this sequence learning process. And where the agent interacts with our simulator, and the simulator is basically using the demand from this data sets to represent where people are. And then we'd have a relatively simple supply model there, supply in terms of travel times. So after learning this, then apply it in new scenarios. So new cities, you see that this exists here, and so we obtain results. I can show you some of the results for those three scenarios. So here, random basically means a random policy. So where you have the rebalancing is simply just, you randomly distribute the cars. ED is equal distribution. So that means it's like a uniform distribution of the vehicles. Zero shot is basically you start a new city and you don't even train anything. You just get the data and you decide already. Fine tune is zero shot, but without really this knowledge that I mentioned that is transmitted from state to state or from task to task in the reinforcement learning before. So you just have a few more examples to fine tune. MetaRL is what I talked about. So it's basically you train in each city and you reuse the knowledge and improve further and further. Single city is the usual way that I said before. So you basically go to the new city, you start from scratch. Which means you have a lot of data that you need to use for this one. And these two MPC are just the perfect model. So in this case, you know really how the world works. You cheat even with Oracle in the sense that you know exactly where the demand will be and so on. So this is not realistic. So basically the results show that MetaRL seems to be quite competitive with respect to what we call sort of the best possible, which is always start, have the full data, start from scratch and everything. Actually beating that one sometimes and being very competitive. Now, of course, MetaRL has a huge gain in sample efficiency. So that means you don't, when you go to the new city, you don't really need so much data to start working. And that's it for my side in terms of the specific case. Kostas, do you want to take over? I think I need to stop sharing.
I think I can, yeah. Trying to find this thing. Okay, can you see the right window or the wrong window?
It's the right one.
Okay, very good. So now I'm going to show a similar case where we're using transfer learning to estimate traffic flow from link speeds from different cities. So the problem here that we are dealing with is that nowadays with the many different services that are being available, offering speed, travel time information, etc., we have a lot of travel time information, which are easy to get. But when we're trying to do demand estimation and prediction, we actually have more experience in doing this with counts. This is more helpful because this is a direct link. And the situation is that essentially we have a sparse situation where we only have data, count data, for a few locations in our network, but typically speed information or travel time for our entire network. So what we want to do is use a machine learning model to increase the observability, so to fill in the missing data with estimates of flows and counts obtained from the speeds, and then use them for what we really wanted to do. Obviously, I'm not going to go through this entire flowchart now. Whoever is interested can look at the paper. We can follow up later. But the idea here is that we look at, we collect some data from the several cities that we're interested in, the source cities, which are the cities with the richer data, and the target cities, which are the cities with the fewer data. And then we perform some sorts of analysis and processing like data fusion, data filtering, and so on. We obtain the data sets, the features that we are going to use, and then perform some exploratory analysis, which is always a good practice and somebody should always use because you find, the devil hidden in the details there. And then estimate the models or learn the models that we need, train the models on the source cities, on the cities where we have all the data, and then use the different scenarios to estimate the models in the city with the fewer data. The one option is to train a similar model. But the most interesting thing is to use the model that has been trained in the city with the richer data and transfer this model to the new city using the fewer data that are available for this city. I hope this will become, I understand that it's not very clear yet. Hopefully it will become a little bit clearer later. But a quick summary is that what we try to do is from link speeds, use a machine learning model to infer link flows, which we then know what to do with. Again, I don't have a lot of time here to look at the details of how we put all the different data sets together, but just to give you an idea, for with different data sets, for example, speeds from floating car data that are available from Uber movement, and then data detector flow data from detectors from various open data portals in the various cities, and network information and speed limits and so on from OpenStreetMaps and so on, we put them all together in augmented data sets that are being used for the training of these models. And here again, I will not go into all the details, but we have different, as we build our model, we have different feature sets and different layers that we consider. So first of all, the primary feature set includes only exogenous features as predictors. So information about the road class, time of day, day of week, month of the year, geometric information like lanes, speed limits, and so on, as well as data about the mean speed and the standard deviation of the speed. And then we have a secondary feature set, which includes other data that may be available, but are not directly related to our dependent variable, to what we are trying to predict for, in this case, occupancy. And then we also have a third level where we're going one step further and we're saying we are also considering time lagged flow as the predictor. So we're using time lagged measurements or estimates of the feature that we are trying to predict. And using all of these, we create a number of layers that we consider in our model. Here, we perform a sensitivity analysis and an exploration to try to understand what is the best configuration of this model. So in this case, we are saying we are varying the loopback length and the prediction horizon. And we see that the best performance comes when we're only considering exogenous variables. So the first, the core data set that I mentioned, we see that the best performance comes when we have a loopback length of 6 hours, so if we look 6 hours into the past, and a one-step prediction. And what this gives us is about almost 17% SMAPE error. When we add occupancy, then we reduce this significantly, less than 10%. And if we also add lagged time flow, link flows, we reduce this to almost 6.5%. What is becoming more interesting is what happens when we are looking at transferring this model. So we trained the model in Paris, which has lots of information, lots of data, and then we want to apply it in Madrid. In the figure here on the right, you see the blue curve, which is the model trained in Madrid, the new model using data for Madrid. If we have a lot of data, in this case, if we use a lot of the data, of course, we have a good performance. As the amount of data that we use gets less than 40% of the overall data, we see, first of all, that the error starts to increase significantly, but also the confidence interval starts to increase, as we expect. On the other hand, if we use the model that we trained for Paris and we transfer it to Madrid using a small amount, already a very small amount of data from Madrid, in this case 20%, in this case 5%, it is much better, first of all, than the data directly trained from Madrid. And the deterioration is not that much. Of course, to preempt your question and to leave room for more interesting questions, yes, Paris and Madrid are similar. If you try to predict for Athens or New Delhi or Lagos, it will be different. This is granted. Now, besides this, what I presented very, schematically, there is also the information on what we freeze or unfreeze, as Francisco mentioned before. So we tried different other combinations of layers, freezing and unfreezing layers, to get the results that right now I think it's not very important, right? At the end of the day, I don't know, Francisco, if you, maybe you can say later, if there is some knowledge in how you choose which layers to freeze or unfreeze. But in our case, it was mostly exploratory at this point, right? So you try some things and then see what sticks. Very good. A similar thing, just to mention, three of my PhD students, Cheng Liu, Qinglong Liu, and Vishal Mahajan, and with another friend of theirs, participated in the New RIPS 2022 Traffic Forecast Challenge, and they got the second place in the extended challenge of ETA, estimated travel time of arrival prediction. Here, the issue was the opposite. So here, what they want to do is, we have a lot of data. They say, we have a lot of link counts. Let's see how we can predict travel times. So it was really the opposite problem. And to conclude, again, without going into a lot of depth, in this case, we have discussed about how we can transfer models. Another idea is to transfer data, and essentially is, can we take the data from one city and use it to generate surrogate data in another city and then feed the model in the new city rather than transferring the model? So can we do data transfer rather than model transfer? And as a conclusion, open data are great, but they also come with an additional burden for consumers, data quality. So whenever we get data that are open, we have there's no guarantee usually. So there is an extra burden for us to make sure that we feel comfortable with this data. And another great thing is that open data, usually when we want to do a specific experiment, we can design the experiment and maybe get even the funding for this if we are lucky and get it. But for cases like COVID, for example, we had no opportunity or time or way to get some design and experiment and prepare for some data collection ahead of time. But most of the studies that have been done rely on opportunistic applications. So for example, Kayak1000 had already a smartphone app that was running on a sample of people, and he used this to also track the impact of COVID. We used Google Popular Times to track the impact of COVID, but this was running already. Another thing is that open data and its quality varies geographically. So the assumptions that we make, oh yeah, everything is available and so on, may not hold universally. So that's a caveat for somebody who might want to try this in that area or in the other area. And finally, it seems from this, relatively early preliminary analysis, I guess Francisco will also agree that there's a lot of more work to be done here, that transfer learning and the other methods that Francisco presented, meta-learning and so on, can help us to bridge the lack of data by knowledge transfer from data-rich contexts to data-scarce contexts. Finally, there are some sources that have been mentioned before if somebody wants to dig deeper, and some tutorials and video lectures that Francisco has put together, the lists, because obviously we scratched the surface of these topics, but these topics are very large, and we hope that generated more interest, and you will go to learn more in these directions and contribute in these research and so on. So thank you very much. And I guess now it's time for some questions and discussion.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much, Kostas and Francisco, for this really great and very clear and very visual scratching the surface, as you mentioned. I think it was really well done, also considering the time constraints here. It's not possible to dive into depth here. But indeed, we still have some minutes left. So I would like to encourage our audience to comment, to question while we have the speakers here live. So feel free to either write in the chat or also raise your hand and speak up. You're very welcome to do so. Seems nobody wants to kickstart. Apparently everything was clear. So that's a compliment.
Yeah, either too clear or not at all. Well,
yes, indeed. Pablo, please.
Hello. Thank you so much for the presentation. Really interesting. Just one question related with tools that you suggest to use for conduct this kind of research. And thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, in terms of the meta-learning side, I mentioned MAML. It's a well-known, well, I mean, there's quite a lot of derivatives of that. So I would strongly encourage you to go to follow that path if you want to go into meta-learning. The black box methods, I mean, some of the other things are more like tailor-made. So you need to design your depending on the problem that you're solving. In terms of transfer learning, the answer is actually it's trickier, but trickier to implement, but conceptually simpler. It's what Kostas said. I mean, basically, you need to figure out that there are these first layers that are somehow similar, and you do a lot of testing. It's a lot of empirical work, really. So in terms of like I said, in terms of packages, I would say that for meta learning, there's a lot. For transfer learning, you need to go, it's case by case, basically.
Thank you very much. And like said earlier, we are very happy to share the slides. So you will also have the list with all the links where you then can follow up and dive deeper into matters. Again, if there's any more questions, please speak up. Yes, Nicola.
Hi, first of all, thanks a lot, Kostas, Francisco, for this super dense presentation. Maybe just one more specific question to Francisco. So you showed the results for meta learning RL compared to a single shot. And there was one case where your meta learning performed poorer. Could you maybe reason a bit why, can you how go? That happened, and maybe also how to reduce the gap?
Well, I mean,
the city that is the problem that is significantly different.
Thanks. That's a good question. Yeah, we discussed this a lot. Well, I mean, first of all, you need to see that when you say poorer, you're talking about maybe New York, Brooklyn, and Shenzhen West, I guess, with respect to single city. The single city is when you have the RL process from scratch in the new city with all the data. And so we were actually surprised, not about that, but that San Francisco was managing to actually beat the single city because you know, with MetaRL, you have trained the model from other cities and you get to the new one and you only have a few examples for the new city. So beating the single city was already hard. Now, why did San Francisco, can you go back one slide, Kostas? I think it relates with similarity with other places. I think it was New York. I don't remember exactly, but we saw that there was a lot of similar patterns I don't remember which one it was, with San Francisco. That's why San Francisco is actually beating the others so so much. But can you go to the next slide again, Kostas? So yeah, so you shouldn't expect, I mean, when we talk about MetaRel, rarely you should expect it to beat the others. Here it's more the efficiency in terms of the sample, the number of samples that you use. In fact, in general, in meta learning, even with MAML, with the, you know, with these like I said, the gradient based methods, which usually perform very well, you shouldn't expect it to beat the case where you have all the data. You understand what I mean? So yeah, I mean, it's these are methods to solve a real world problem, which is you have less data, you have less time, you have a very expensive resources. Yeah, and I think in transfer learning it's kind of similar. Yeah, I hope I answered your question.
Apparently so. Yes. So we still have time for one or two more. If there's any burning ones, now's your chance. That is not the case. Yes, absolutely. Please go ahead.
So if you would consider now a fourth city, would you be able or expect to be able somewhere in the future to tell the city how much data you would need from them for reasonable or good estimates?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, there are studies about this, about the trying to figure out this ratio of training versus test. Meta training versus meta test. So the number of and the complexity of the data that you have in the training set and the complexity and the data that you need in the test set, in the meta test set. So which are these cases? I copy a bit what Kostas said when he said that if you go, I mean, in this case, he was mentioning, Paris and Madrid? Yeah. So, I mean, you said that, I mean, if you go to New Delhi or Athens, that it would be quite unsure that the results would be so good. And I would say, I mean, in meta learning, it is related. So what you need to think about is how, it's not so much the complexity of the city, is if behaviors are fundamentally different. So if behaviors of demand, for example, with respect to the network, with respect to the service are different. So, I mean, in all cases that you have there, you'd have very large cities. Maybe, I don't know, if we go to Lund or to some small city, maybe I think that you'd need more data. But can you go back again, Kostas? But you'll notice that even with zero shot, you have a pretty decent reward. I mean, if you compare with random, that's for sure. I mean, what we expect is that if you have a service like this and you go to a new, like your Uber, you have an autonomous Uber and you go to the new place, I would expect that you'd start with zero shot and you'd use the data, you know, from the feedback to retrain it. I think so. I mean, if you have a situation where you really don't, you cannot afford much experimentation. You did I answer your question? Yeah. Yes, Pablo?
Yes, Francisco, the last question from my side. I was thinking about, you mentioned, okay, it depends on the case, and really simple or brief description, I use a database that is related with the environmental impact, right? This database. I need to pay for that. It's not a free open access resource. And the point is related with the maybe aspect that I need to consider when I will publish. I explain better. Imagine that using this database, I carry out the procedure and apply for a particular case, and I am the owner of this data is the first point. And also the second point is related with the license or the copyright things that I need to carry out when I consider this kind of experience. In your case, if you have some maybe tips for us, will be relevant. Thank you so much again.
Mm-hmm. Maybe Costas can.
In this, from my point of view, I try to stay out of these things and let the others, the lawyers or whoever, deal with that. I hate that we have to deal with these things and these limitations that don't let us work. And quite often when we collaborate with people or want to collaborate with people or people want to collaborate with us, that's where we stick, right? Because I say, look, if we cannot publish, then why would I spend my time for free? Because typically I'm not getting paid. I am from anywhere else other than university. Okay, the students will be paid, but still, if they also cannot publish, I mean, they don't do what they do for their salary. It's not so great. They could get much more money somewhere else. They do it to get to publish, to go on and so on. So there is some currency somewhere there that is important. But from our point of view, for me, I try to make everything open. And I wish more things were open. It's a negotiation at every point. The question you say, of course, of who owns the generated data, that's something else. So that's very important. So for example, in this future vision that I'm having, and I'm saying, okay, I'm going to generate something based on something else. And we're all nowadays with ChatGPT, everybody's learned about generative AI. So now, who owns the images that are based on my photograph, for example, or on my, I think already there are court, they have sued companies that Getty and so on has sued OpenAI because they're generating images based on their catalog. And they're saying they should give them revenue for that. So I think there is a new, whole new era to try to understand and figure out, but I stay out of it.
Yeah. I'd like to add, so follow up on that with respect to generative models and that issue. I mean, in principle, I almost like Costas, I try to stay out of the discussion. And whenever there is, it's possible to generate data that is somehow statistically representative of what you want to solve with a problem, right? I mean, if you don't, let's say in Denmark, we have this data set, this travel survey data set, and it's hard to share. But some of us are working on a generative model that can copy, you know, fake people that do fake surveys, right? But they're statistically representative of a realistic behavior. In that case, it's more like an opinion. I think that as long as you don't violate GDPR constraints, I think this should be open, because this is how the field can evolve. This is how deep learning evolved a lot with these open data sets with images, really a lot. And ChatGPT would not exist if it wasn't for the open, the text available with Wikipedia, for example. So if we are also protective, it's going to be complicated. I'm not sure if we answered your question,
And I don't think we are the problem also, right? The ones that are protective usually, but yeah.
Yeah.
Great, wonderful. Maybe at that point, I can also make a quick promotion, because we're going to have an online event on the 25th of May on the EU Artificial Intelligence Act, where we will touch exactly on these questions with researchers from our universities and with the European Commission. This is going to regulate the work in the field of AI in the future here in Europe. But I will include that in my follow-up email, I will also include the slides and the link to this recording. We are on time exactly. So I would like to thank first and foremost our two speakers. Thank you so much for the presentation and for the preparation of this talk and for being available also for the questions. And of course, for everybody to join and to listen and to ask your questions. So see you hopefully around and have a nice afternoon. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.